Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wildberger. Okay, so we're going to talk about elementary row operations on matrices. So this is moving towards explaining row reduction or Gaussian elimination, a systematic approach to solving systems of linear equations. Okay, so the first thing to do is to remind you that we had a matrix formulation for a system of equations. So here, for example, is system of three equations in four variables, x1, x2, x3, x4. There's three equations, and correspondingly here below it, you see an augmented matrix for that system. Okay, and we see just on the left-hand side is the encoding of all the coefficients that appear on the left-hand side of the equations. And then on the right-hand side here, the column 1, 2, 3 is just the column that appearing on the right-hand side of the system of equations. So the idea is that instead of working with the equations, we're going to work with the augmented matrix instead. And the advantage of that, obviously, is that we don't have to keep writing down the variables x1, x2, x3, x4, because the positions of those variables is already kind of clear by the way the matrix organizes things, okay? So we can just work with these numbers and then interpret what we get in terms of the original equations. Now, the strategy is that we are going to use three different transformations or operations on augmented matrices. And these operations that we're going to use have the crucial property that they do not change the solution set. Okay, so whatever is a solution to the original system will still be a solution to any of these modified matrices that we're going to create. And conversely, any solution of a modified augmented matrix that we get is also a solution to the original system. So that's the key point, that we're making transformations that don't ultimately change the set of solutions to our system. So we use three different operations on augmented matrices. Maybe we should say matrices that do not change the solutions. Okay, and these are, so the first one is interchange of any two rows. And the second one is going to be adding multiple of one row to another. The third one is going to be multiplying a row by a non-zero number. Okay, so these are going to be called, these are going to be called elementary row operations. And they're going to be acting on augmented matrices for a system. We're also going to introduce some kind of notation for these. So let us have an example or two. So let's look at the first one. Interchange of two rows. Okay, so suppose we have some augmented matrix. Maybe 2, 4, 3, 7, 1, 0, 2, minus 5, and 4, 1 half, 3, 2. I remind you that the numbers involved here don't always have to be integers. Usually we will illustrate things with integers, but we don't actually officially have to. And in fact, later on, we'll see that fractions do naturally appear. Okay, so what might we want to do? We might want to interchange two rows. And our notation is that our first row will denote by R1, and our second row by R2, and our third row by R3. Okay, that's the convention that we'll use. So now we're going to make a transformation, and we're going to change this to the following one. 1, 0, 2, minus 5, 2, 4, 3, 7, 4, 1 half, 3, 2. Okay, what have I done here? I have interchanged R1 and R2, and we'll denote that with this little symbol here, R1, so double arrow, R2. That's telling us that we're interchanging row 1 and row 2 of the original matrix to get this new matrix. Now, that's pretty clearly not going to change the solutions to this system, because remember, each one of these rows corresponds to a linear equation, in this case, x1, x2, x3, perhaps, or we don't actually know what the variables are. Maybe the variables are x, y, and z. But whatever they are, the three equations that we have at the end, in the second matrix, is exactly the same as the equations that we have in the first matrix. It's just that they're in a different order. So we just change the order of the equations. That's not going to change, you know, what the solutions are. Why might we want to do this? So we might want to do this because it's really convenient to have a 1 in the top of a column that we're working on. We're going to be working on kind of clearing elements from columns. And having a 1 there makes it particularly convenient to remove, by subsequent row operations, the entries below that. So it's a kind of a way of organizing or bookkeeping the row reduction algorithm, okay? That's why we do this kind of thing. It's usually to bring a more convenient entry to the top of some column. Okay, it's a relatively simple operation. The second one is the most used. So it is adding a multiple of one row to another. Adding a multiple of one row to another. So let's illustrate that. Say I'll start with that matrix that we just had in the previous example, 1, 0, 2, minus 5, 2, 4, 3, 7, and 4, 1 half, 3, 2. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to transform this by changing the second row. And I'm going to change the second row by adding a multiple of the first row to it in order to get rid of that 2 that's sitting there underneath the 1. Okay, so that's what our plan is, to get rid of that 2, to make it a 0. And the way we're going to do that is we're going to actually add minus 2 times the first row to the second row. And the way we're going to write that is in kind of computer language. So we're going to write R2 equals, this is like the new R2 on the left-hand side of the equation, that's the way you should interpret that, is equal to the old R2 minus 2 times R1. Okay, so then we're going to get a new system. The first row is not going to change, but the second row is, because we're going to subtract twice the first row from it. So 2 minus 2 is 0. 4 minus 2 times 0 is still 4. 3 minus 2 times 2 is minus 1. We also have to do it on the right-hand side. 7 minus 2 times minus 5 is a total of 17. And the third row, well, we're not doing anything to that, so we'll leave it where it is. Okay, so let's make sure that we understand what this notation means here. So we have added minus 2 times the first row, R1, to the second row, R2. And to understand what's really going on there, so let's have a look at what it looks like at the level of equations. So at the level of equations, maybe we'll use x, y, and z as our variables. Okay. So the first equation that we originally had was x plus 2z equals minus 5, and then 2x plus 4y plus 3z equals 7, and 4x plus 1/2y plus 3z equals 2. And then after we've performed this, we still have x plus 2z equals minus 5, and now we have 2x minus 2x is 0x plus 4y minus 3z equals 17. And we still have 4x plus 1/2y plus 3z equals 2. So we performed, well, actually at this level, it's perhaps safer to say that we have just worked on the level of equations. So equation 2 equals the old equation 2 minus 2 times the equation 1. And that might be a corresponding thing in terms of equations rather than rows. And we can see that this is not going to change the solution set. And why is that? So note that any vector, say x, y, z, which satisfies the first system also satisfies the second system. Right? Because if x, y, and z satisfy these three equations here, then these three equations here are obtained from these ones by just combining them. So these ones, these new ones over here, are just going to still be satisfied if x, y, and z satisfy the original set. But what about the converse question? How do we know that anything that satisfies the second equation also satisfies the first equation? So that's sort of the converse. So conversely, we can see that any solution of the second system is also a solution to the first system, because the operation is invertible. Because the operation that we've just done is invertible, which is another way of saying reversible. We can undo it. How would we undo that? So how would we go back and recreate the first system from the second system? Let's think about that. I'm going to do that over here in blue, all right? Suppose that we started with the system on the right-hand side, this one here, and we wanted to go to this one over here. Let's do it in red, okay? What would we do? Well, the first equation is the way it is. The third equation is the way it is. Only the second equation is being changed. And what actually is happening to the second equation? The new second equation, that is the one over here, is equal to the old second equation plus 2 times the first equation. You see that, right? So if we take this equation, the second one over here, and we add twice the first one over here, then we're going to recover the second equation over on the original side. That's explaining how to undo or how to invert or how to reverse this second elementary row operation. And that's the reason why it's also the case that if we have a solution to the second one, the one on the right-hand side, then we'll also get a solution to the left-hand one, because the left-hand one is obtained from the right-hand one by just taking equations and adding multiples of one to the other. Okay. So this is a kind of the key operation, right? This is the one that you do, like, you know, 90% of the time, really. Okay, so we're going to be using this operation quite a lot. But there's also a third one. The third operation is to multiply a row by a non-zero number. Okay, so let's go back to the last matrix that we had, the 102 minus 5, 102 minus 5, and then the next one was 04 minus 117, 04 1 minus 17, and then the last one was 4 half 3 2, 4 1 half 3 2. Okay, so let us transform this by using this third kind of elementary row operation. And why might we want to do that? Well, usually it's to normalize the numbers that appear. Sometimes it's because we want to remove fractions. Sometimes it's because we want to create a one in a particular spot. So let's illustrate that here, because let's have a look at this third row, which we haven't done anything with yet. So let's take the third row. Actually, we're going to use notation for row. So row 3, let's take row 3. And the new row 3 is going to be 2 times the old row 3. Okay. So this equation that I've just written is not really a good mathematical equation. It's the kind of equation that a computer scientist might use in a sort of a programming environment. So the left-hand side is referring to the new row 3, while the right-hand side refers to the old row 3, and it's saying that the new row 3 is going to be twice the old row 3. Okay, so what do we get out of this? Well, the first row stays where it is, and the second row stays where it is, and the third row is multiplied by 2. So we get 8, 1, 6, 4. And so we performed that, that operation. And we also note that this is also invertible or reversible . To reverse it, we would just multiply by the inverse of what we multiplied previously. By the inverse or the reciprocal. And for that, of course, it is important that we're agreeing to multiply row by a non-zero number. You are not allowed to multiply a row by 0. That's effectively killing that row. Then you're losing information. It's no longer the same kind of system. So that's not an allowed operation, because we want the set of solutions to stay the same, right? In this case, it's kind of obvious that it stays the same if you just take an equation and you multiply both left and right hand sides by the same number, in this case 2. The solutions are not changing. It just becomes more convenient for the algorithm to use that equation in that altered form. Okay, so these are the three elementary row operations, and we are now going to then exploit them to show how to solve systems of linear equations. So we'll do that next time.